Radiant Team.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the broadcast. My name is Suns Fan Joan by Sindarin. This is the Dota 2 Asia Championships wild card match between Radiant Power Team Rangers back. And Energy Pacemaker Gaming. Let's get into the game.
Let's get into the draft. Yeah, that's where it's just, it's such a weird name. It's so bad, it's good. It's hard not, I don't know. I don't know how they came up with it. We still don't actually know if there is any sort of sponsorship with the pacemaker producer or whatever. But it's a very interesting team name, to say the least. We've had some interesting team names in the past, and I don't know. I'm not sure what's going on with it. But regardless, Energy Pacemaker will be playing against Power Rangers. A little bit of energy in both names. Power versus energy. Who's stronger? Who's the bigger Pokemon?
Power Pacemakers. That would have been pretty good.
Energy Rangers.
Yeah, okay.
They could swap around. Or energy, yeah. Power Pacemaker sounds
We're going to see Axe again, but this time PR is going to be taking it along with Tidehunter. And that means Tiny Radiant Wisp will be going the way of Energy Pacemaker Gaming. I'm going to keep saying this name over and over again. It's so good.
It really... regardless of whether, like, what you're... It's just a standout name, no matter what. Like, it's funny to see that, a name like that in the game, but... Yeah, we're gonna see how this one goes. Obviously, Iotiny for Team EP, which is a kind of standard opener. I think Axe is pretty good against those two, to be honest. Whenever Iotiny come in with a relocate, you have the chance to go for the blink call. You even have Tide on top of that. It looks like they're just already planning on, okay, how do we deal with Iotiny? That's like everything they want to do in the lineup. And I think it's the right approach when an opponent picks Iotiny that you immediately address that problem first in the draft, instead of being, looking ahead and being like, okay, we'll counterpick them on the fourth and fifth, and then the counterpicks you wanted get banned out. Just grab them immediately so you've dealt with that part of the draft and then move on. So,
see, the disruptor this time would make a lot of sense for Power Rangers, unlike last game.
It'd be good too. Kind of was underwhelming there. I didn't really like their draft so much in the last game, at least not how they laned and played it out.
It felt like they chose the lineup beforehand.
Yeah, it really did. Or this time it looks like they're counterpicking way more, which is generally a better approach. Just blind picking your own lineup is often not the best idea. Reserve time. We'll see. Oh, I just noticed. Look at the description of the tournament. That's a very short, very concise description. 16 top teams compete for grand honor.
That's pretty legit, actually. Go. I like
that.
That's
simple and to the point.
Grand. What is grand honor exactly? Hmm.
Something nice. You don't have.
If there was a contest for soda, I might. Terrorblade going to be banned out for Energy Pacemaker Gaming. They're going to pick up a silencer, so
Radiant
he can help out with the ganks, with Wisp and Tiny, obviously, just being on the other side of the map. It can prevent any counter initiation going the way to disrupt that relocate gank. And silencer, we've been seeing a little bit more lately. I mean, it's always been like a good pick, but ever since, I mean, this is way back when, the Aghanims and Refresher became ridiculous, although I guess technically it's been nerfed a bit.
Dire team pick.
Still very potent. I mean, Curse the Silent on every single hero, and then you do it twice. It's probably one of the most, if not the most annoying spells to go against.
It's really good, and I think a big part of the problem with Silencer is that the mentality around picking the hero is that everyone just focuses on global, which is, of course, it is his ultimate. It is an important ability, but people often forget that there's more merit to picking this hero than just Global Silence. He's the only support with an orb attack, which is extremely good for lane harassment. You can just stand in the middle of the creep wave and hit the enemy away, which is very, very useful. Same story if you're playing as a Chorus, a solo mid, you can harass like that. Both Last Word and Curse, very good against specific heroes. Curse can completely ruin the life of an Axe in lane, for example. He has one active spell that he can cast, and he can cast it like twice, and then he's out of mana, and then Curse just ruins him in the lane, forces him to use it first, and then after that he has nothing. You could also get Battle Hunger, but that's actually also fairly expensive to cast for him compared to his mana pool. So I like the Silencer pick if they use it for more than the global. I think if teams just pick Silencer only for the global, it's just, yes, it's good.
Well, what if he's
but
not
it puts
support,
a lot
though?
Of, yeah, well, then you definitely don't pick him for only global, right? Then you pick him for...
You pick him to get those two items.
Yeah, well,
that's
then...
pretty much the only reason.
But that's kind of a big difference, because then it's not just global anymore. Then it's a global that also damages, and you get levels, so you also have more skill points in the other abilities, which changes it. But having global silence is great, but keep in mind that the hero can do more than that when you play it. They're going to get Shaker, too. So it is... Either of them is a core now. I don't think... I mean, if you play Iotiny, you would not put Io as the core out of these three. So it might be.
I would
be,
love to see that.
Might be a solo mid silencer.
10 seconds remaining.
That would be really nice. Or solo mid shaker, which I agree with less against those particular heroes. Remaining. I don't think this is a core shaker game. He needs to commit into the fight, then something out of these three heroes is going to bother him. They have ice armor. They have obviously a lot of armor and axe. They have anchor smash. Which this is not a game where you want to play more than one melee core.
Dire
especially not
back.
Now. Now there's a cask too.
Yeah, I mean
they're really
Lich,
counterpicking.
Lich
this
and Witch Doctor, pretty damn
Lich
good
Doctor.
Against Io Tiny. I mean the cask, the Chain Frost, pretty potent overall. I mean the Death Ward, Witch Doctor in all likelihood will be the four, so getting
Radiant
Aghanim Scepter isn't necessarily out of the realm of possibilities. I mean, not often we see a Lich other than a five. I mean I'm just assuming that's gonna be the case. Of course it could be an offlane Lich, technically
Dire
speaking, but highly
pick.
Doubtful. I mean, but if it's Earthshaker mid. Maybe you want to put Axe or Tidehunter mid to counteract that a bit. We'll see what they end up choosing. But
I think they're
going
to play.
Luna's going to be banned. Interesting.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure why they were so scared of Luna with their lineup. They actually, I think EP had really good heroes against Luna, to be honest. A little bit surprising ban to see out here. What we could, I think a pick that you could expect out of Power Rangers this game would be the Morphling. Really good dual laner with Lich, I think. Does well against Io Tiny too. You can relocate out, you can, why is the name of that? Replicate out. Wow, that just went out of mind. So replicate it, you can waveform. Of course, Global Silence can be a little bit worrisome, but apart from that, Morphling seems like a pretty solid choice for me here for PR. What alternatives are there? I wouldn't run a melee core into that lineup of EP. Running a melee core into Tiny Shaker is really difficult. So any sort of range carry for me is probably the best choice. And preferably one that has some sort of escape.
All right.
We'll see.
Well, only 24 seconds to go for Energy, Pacemaker, Gaming. And PR actually has a ton of time to work with, so they can last pick with pretty much no worry of the time running out.
Invoker.
And Invoker's going to be the pick for
Radiant
Energy, Pacemaker,
wait,
Gaming.
Wait a second. How are they laning this on Dire?
So who is it going to be? So Invoker in all likelihood, it could be Tiny Io mid. No, I don't know. This is kind of odd.
They could be dual lane offlaning Shaker Silencer.
What do you
I
think about?
I would definitely not put Invoker offlane in inner circumstances.
Phantom
PA again.
They're going to go with it again. And they're running this. Okay, so it's a lot better this time than it was in the Navi game because PA is, if you want a melee core against Tiny, it's the best. The 50% evasion is huge. You actually have a hero that can do enough physical damage to kill off Tiny, who has very low base armor and needs to itemize for it. So I think this is a better draft for PR than the one we saw in the previous game. EP, I have to admit, we didn't get to watch that game, but EP did play against Wings. I don't know who won that game, but what I did see from it was that it was fairly close. So this is kind of an indicator of if you want to make like a power ranking during the wild card of these teams. I think after this second round, we will know who looks like the favorites, obviously. So, but I really need to see how EP lane this. This looks a little bit odd, whereas PR's is way more straightforward.
Well, with this pause, let's go over the lineups as we have some time. Cheshire Cat can be playing Axe for PR, DTR Ra on the PA yet again, Chashlo on the Tidehunter, J4 Lich, and Sineko on the Wish Doctor. And for Energy, Pacemaker, Gaming, you want to take this?
Sure.
I like Earthshaker's name.
Yeah, I do. I apologize. I don't know exactly how to pronounce these Chinese characters, so I'm just going to just call him Two, because that's what we can see. So we've got Two on the Shaker. We've got Le on Io. Luffy will be playing as Invoker. I've got LT on Silencer. And finally, Fan on Tiny. I love that he's called Stand-In Fan. It's like he's playing the game of his dreams right here.
Indeed. Well, they're going to amalgamate in their own forest here. I'm going to put down an early ward to see for this bounty run, see if they can perhaps get an early kill. But with a Tidehunter, it's going to be pretty difficult, although they should be able to secure the rune for themselves. And right now, nobody really at bottom rune. How big of a deal do you think the bounty runes are these days?
A really big deal.
Like, and what I mean by that is, like, if you have the mid, you still block, right? I mean, you never do a five-man rune.
You generally contest. Actually, I think a lot of the times we see four heroes on one rune and one hero on the other rune. Mm-hmm. to secure one and then try for the other one sometimes. I just think the bounty rune is more valuable than a block. The thing is, if the mid laner comes to get the bounty rune and then also doesn't block, and the other mid laner blocks or gets a bounty rune, that's quite a significant difference. Right. So I think you need to do either. But it doesn't have to be the mid laner blocking. Oh, nice cast. Good avalanche from Fan as well, though. But both bounty runes will be going the way of Power Rangers. So
that was a great steal. That cask is already annoying the crap out of EP. So we'll see if that continues to be the... I mean, that was an easy rune, too. I thought that was for sure going their way, but not the case. So it's going to be Earthshaker offlane versus PA. That should be really interesting, although it's going to be with Sineko helping out on that Witch Doctor. And it is the dual lane Tiny IO versus Tidehunter. I don't think they're going to be able to get a kill on Tide. All he's looking for, as I say, that he gets taken down at half HP, but very survivable here on his own right. Four tangles on top of that, of course. Top lane, man, this last word is going to be super annoying to go against.
Silencer is really good in lane against X. Glaives of Wisdom are pure damage, so even when he has a lot of armor from Berserker's Call, you can still do damage with them. Both Last Word and Curse just destroy him, but he is playing in lane with a Lich, so I think this one is going to be fairly even. I would probably give the edge to EP by a little bit, which is really good if you're playing against a Lich lane in 2-1-2 and you still, on paper, have the stronger lane. At the same time, obviously, they're going to win the mid lane for sure against the Tide. However, Witch Doctor's there too, and he's going to go for the Courier Snipe, I think. He's been standing here for so long, and now he's not even going to see it. Oh. He's going to try to get it on the way back.
Yeah, he's going to...
But now the bottle has been delivered.
Ooh, he's going to get it.
Yep.
Two right clicks is all it takes. Of course, nothing Dyer's on the courier itself, but either
still
way.
Still very, very well worth it.
I mean, if he had gotten that with the bottle, that would have been crippling. I mean, yeah. Wisp completely relies on that. Axe is actually going to get a kill at top lane versus the Silence.
Great camera work by Suns Fan as we're continuing.
I technically saw it.
Really?
I had like half of it on the screen, so it's
yeah, I saw all of it. I just wasn't telling you.
Yeah, right. So typical.
Oh yeah, that's the first blood for PR. In a lane, they shouldn't get the first blood in, to be honest. This is not a lane that Axe Lich can kill.
Urshak is going to get the fissure off, but a lot of harassment damage coming the way of PR. Top rune's going to go the way of Lei on the Wisp. And with that bottle, this hero is just insane. Tiny doesn't have to worry about any mana regeneration, because it'll all come the way of that Wisp feather. And overcharge, nothing. Eventually.
Tide is doing well, though. He actually has the same farm as Tiny in this lane, which is a little bit surprising. Tide definitely one of the better heroes at standing against Io Tiny, but it's still, he shouldn't be getting free farm. The Io needs to be on his face as much as possible, just harass, 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 and then whenever they can, do the toss avalanche combo, because if they let Tide get this much of a grip on the lane, they might not be even be able to kill him later on, which kind of what usually defines Io Tiny mid is that if they play 2-on-1, they almost always find one kill at some point, but it just doesn't seem likely if Cheshire Cat, or sorry, Xiaoshlo, who is playing Tide this time around, if he gets a good start.
Frost Blast onto Invoker.
Are they going to get him
with the
again?
Battle Hunger. A couple more right clicks. This is a level 1 Battle Hunger. Not going to matter. He's actually going to get the kill thanks to his counter Helix. He's going to find Silencer, who's just going to walk away. Berserker's Call's up, but I don't think it's going to be nearly enough damage to get that kill. But either way, this lane is one and in spades for PR.
Yeah, they're looking really good now with X with Tranquils as well as three tangos still remaining. I can't help but feel like EP should have probably been able to harass him a little bit more. We saw the opener where they harassed him really well, and after that, this just it's been all about PR in that top lane. Tide is still, he's out farming the Tiny, which is like unheard of in this mid lane. And then at the same time, bottom lane, PA is also getting free farm against, however, offlane Shaker is actually doing fairly well too, up to 9 CS. Has to go back to base, but Arcane's not far off if that's what he wants.
Yeah, pretty damn close overall. They tried to toss Tiny into the tower, but tossed a creep instead. And I mean, that's one of the things when playing Tiny in this capacity where the toss, I always talk about this mechanic where it's not the closest target, it's just a random target in the area. It's super difficult when there's a full wave. They're going to secure the rune for themselves. So in the end, really, obviously the gold was a huge benefit for PR getting that courier, but as far as thwarting the efforts of Wisp, hasn't really done much because he just basically got every single rune that he's wanted. And Tiny, but like you said, Tidehunter is definitely holding his own in this mid lane, which is not expected at all.
PR is just winning all three lanes, to be honest.
Top lane, Cheshire Cat has absolutely no mana. Getting a cold snap. Sunstrike's going to miss. Rykla's going to continue. Glaives of Wisdom, he's going to pop his wand. Has a bottle charge. He's going to be okay, I think. And on he lives. In fact, he wants to perhaps turn this.
That would be a really manly play.
Yeah, I mean, he's a 1-1-3 right now as far as skill builds are concerned. Mid lane, Gank Attempt incoming versus Tiny, who's just used Avalanche.
The Duo of Ravage would love to get this kill as Cheshire Cat. He's forcing the Io in the top lane to tether to the Silencer, effectively holding three heroes here on his own. And if Fan tries to go for anything here, he's dead.
They could probably just dive him, honestly.
Yeah, I think they could. Ravage. They could just Ravage open him and then kill him. But they might want to not use the Ravage unless they have to.
Yeah, I think he has an idea that they're somebody's missing off the map. And they're just going to back up. So he's going to continue to get the farm that he wants, but...
Oh, maybe they find Lei. Witch Doctor is going to find him. Has the cask and Maledict.
Is he going to bounce again? Nope. Right clicks are there. He's going to tether up into the Tiny, who's going to go for the kill here. An Avalanche to Sunstrike's going to hit. Oh my god, that burst damage is out of control. They're going to continue the pressure against Witch Doctor. There's the Ravage. It's going to hit too, along with the Wild Wind Ripper, whatever you want to call it. And the toss comes out as well. And Witch Doctor falls to the ground. So it's a 2-for-1 overall, top lane. Cheshire Cat just doing everything. He's getting away with everything here. Level 6, almost 7.
He just solo killed that Invoker. He's now level 7 against level 4 Invoker in lane. Okay, under these circumstances, Axe will be dominating now. Like, there's no way they can stop him unless they have to dual lane against him. Else he will, at the very least, free farm at this point. So this Axe has been working out wonderfully for PRS. They do secure a rune for Tide as well. They might want to go on this. With this Avalanche missing, they have all the kill potential in the world right now.
Avalanche toss Cheshire Cat. He's not going to have any mana at the moment. Doesn't have any ball charges either. They're going to continue with the Wisp. Here comes J4. Doesn't have his ult or anything, but Frostbust does a lot of damage. IO extremely low. Culling Blade, not enough mana for it. A beautiful Fissure is going to block off Joshua, but of course, he does have the haste. He's going to end up getting the kill with a couple more right clicks and maybe an Anchor Smash. He uses his tether onto Tiny, gets another toss off, gets the kill, double kill for Silencer overall. And now Tidehunter on the run, and here comes Detail Ra. It's a 3-for-2 overall. Somehow Tiny lives. Sunstrike looks like it was off the mark looking for Chachlo. And Invoke, this is actually insane. Invoke level 4. Holy
jeez. That was a very chaotic fight. I think it's... I want to say EP come out on top just because of how, at this point, with how terrible the early game went, I would have expected them to lose these kind of fights. So even if they get an even trade, I think it favors them just to get some levels up on their core. Especially Tiny now being level 7 is going to be a huge deal. Can start solo killing heroes at this point with a combo.
Uh-oh, top lane. Battle Hunger.
Yeah, he's
so call,
dead.
And he has backup from J4. This is going to be more than enough with the dunk. And that lane is just absolutely been dominated by this Axe, who is now... level almost 8 at this point. Has 1,200 gold. He picked up something. Did he not have Tranquils before? I'm not sure. I thought he had 1,200 gold just a minute ago. So.
No, I just think that kill didn't give him that much gold. Although, yeah, well, it gave 245. I think he just bought a TP scroll and got that kill. And that's it. But the Blink is not far away. I'm assuming he's going to go for that instead of the Vanguard we saw last game from Funnik. This is a different kind of game where the Blink Dagger on him is going to be incredibly valuable for setting up his team as a first item. See Invoke reporting him again. He might just go for it. Look at that.
Well, he's not going to have enough mana for the entire combo, especially with Silencer here, putting Curse of the Silent upon Axe. Actually, that's the last word.
He's not using it yet. No, he will, I guess.
And there we go.
He has three bottom charges in one.
Exactly. So he's just going to say, I mean, he's not really worried about dying at this point. He's 1,700 gold, though, so now that he's decently close to that Blink Dagger, perhaps he should play a little bit safer. But meanwhile, bottom lane, Detail Ra going to be pushing this tier 1 just a bit. So Naco going to be getting some jungle farm out of it with that level 2 cask.
Relocate. Oh, he missed the Fissure.
Fissure does miss, but the Avalanche is there into a Sunstrike. That is enough damage. That takes the entire team, literally, for EP to take out the Axe. What trades do we have here for PR? Josh Lowe's here in mid. Relocate coming back. Ravage on top of both of them into an Anchor Smash. That's one dead right off the bat. Fan getting brought down. Toss is not going to save you in this scenario. In fact, the TP, a beautiful Echo Summon on everybody. Fissure on top of that. Detail Ra falls to the ground. Josh Lowe on the run. Doesn't look like he's going to go down, at least not yet. Urshaker has Maledict applied to him. And that's going to break things up. So it's a 2-for-2 overall in this miniature engagement. That was actually pretty sick. That was a really long TP for Earthshaker, but they didn't move, and Echo Slam does a lot of damage.
It's kind of funny to think about that if he had one more level in Aftershock when he came in there. I think he had 4-1-1, and now he leveled up. One more level in Aftershock, and he gets a double kill. That was all it took. The Tide got away with, like, 50 health. Would have been stunned long enough and taken a little more damage, and the tower would have got him. But
we've been seeing Earthshakers not max Fissure a lot lately, but this one does. Can you explain that?
Yeah, so Shaker is one of the heroes where people do build very differently depending on the situation. A lot of the time when you're playing a core Shaker, you see Enchant Totem maxed up because it's just when you get the farm, that ability is, it's really good for securing last hits in lane, and if you get an opener, it's extreme amounts of physical damage output you can get out of it. That's probably the most common build on Core Shakers, and then the less common one is maxing Aftershock, which I'm not really a big fan of. Of course, with the low cooldown and Enchant Totem, if you can get it multiple times, you can get quite a lot of stun duration out of it, but it's just way more situational for my taste. So I still think, overall, for Shakers, Fisher is still the most solid build in most cases, I would say.
Witch Doctor getting close to level 6. Our Shaker has 1,200 gold, and Tidehunter should have his blink about now. In fact, he basically does another 10 gold, and he has a couple ancient stacks to take out.
Hopefully going to get 10 gold from this.
Barely going to get it. Buys his blink, and if he can use that as a surprise factor, that could be pretty big. I mean, so far his Ravages have been really, really good, and they've picked up a lot of kills as a result, but it is 9-7. So
bottom lane relocate, Soneko, he is so dead.
Avalanche tossed, Wisp on top of your face. There's the TP support. Cheshire Cat is here. Doesn't have Berserker's Call for another 10 seconds. Chainfrost going to continue to bounce. It's going to hit IO one more time, but it's not enough to get the kill. Here comes more pressure. Tiny toss on top of the Sunstrike, which is going to miss. Fissure going to connect on Cheshire Cat into the Avalanche. Another right click should finish him off. Silencer gets his credit for that kill. DTL Ra got the Phantom Strike out. There's the Global Silence a little bit late, but Choshul, of course, does have that Ravage, and they don't know that he has that Blink Dagger as of yet. So if they continue to dive, this would be pretty big. Here comes... He actually does get the Wisp. That was a really weird animation. Fissure on top of that. There's the Avalanche toss. It's going to finish off the Tidehunter. And 2 gets this beautiful Echo Slam on 2. Pun intended, yes indeed. Witch Doctor on the run. Last word might be enough to finish him off. Sunstrike, not going to connect. He's barely going to live, but Avalanche toss again. Look at this damage from Tiny. He's just going balls deep continually. He's going to get 2. That's an ultra kill for Fan. And even Urshik is going to get out with his life.
Wow, that was incredibly important for EP. They got so much out of that. This is going to be a 12-minute Aghanim Scepter on Tiny all of a sudden. He has 61 CS and 8 kills. Everything that PR managed to build up in the start is just gone. Look at the graph. It's literally a zero gold game now. Actually, less than zero now, or more than zero, depending on how you look at it. The graph itself, it's now dipping down toward EP. That fight just completely brought them back, even into the lead of this game. And it's... What really matters in that situation is the Chain Frost is completely wasted. It hit IO once, didn't bounce. They don't get the Ravage off because it had a 3-second cooldown and then Tide died. And the initiation from Axe missed, too. I don't think that could have gone any worse for PR, almost. And it was somewhat of an even fight. They got, like, 2-for-4, I think. But that's just not good enough, especially not when Tiny... Or 2-for-5, even, so never mind that. When Tiny gets all the kills, that is a really big deal.
And his farm's going to be out of control now that he has that Aghanim Scepter. Watch for the stacks to come out. Although, Invoker's in the jungle right now. I mean, I'm expecting some ancient stacks to come about. But either way... this is a ridiculously early Aghanim's. I can't remember the last time I saw this early. Is that top lane?
Yep, they're going to go for the tower.
Back door of that tower. No problem. Although there's TP support.
Some problem.
All right, it's actually deniable. Joshua actually... I guess he didn't use Ravage in that last fight. That's right.
He's thinking about it, but that would have been a really risky play. They will get the deny at the very least for this TP, so easily worth it. Tiny did leave IO, or the other way around, up here. So he's going to continue getting support. I don't know. Like, with Tiny getting that ultra kill, I think this is a game where he can completely dominate now. Before that, it was a little shaky.
Early?
I don't know. With Tread's Axe 11 or 12 minutes, I think I've seen it. The main times it comes to mind is with the old Fnatic, with IO played by No-Tail, and then the era Tiny. They managed to get it quite a few times, and that was off getting like 6 or 7 kills in the early game, just like Fan has managed to in this game. So... You don't get... I think 11-minute Treads Axe is possible with 100% free farm safe lane, but...
Tether at the last second's going to avoid a lot of damage here.
Initiation
into the Fissure. That's 2 kills, both for Earthshaker, and the pressure's going to be continued upon PA. He's going to attempt to TP out, but the right clicks are way too much. With that Aghanim Scepter tree-holding piece of garbage Tiny. And they're going to take out this Tier 1 in all likelihood. There is Ravage, but... Nobody's going to be alive for this.
They are getting so much out of this Core Shaker, really. He's been playing very, very well so far, too, on that Shaker.
I can't remember the last time I've seen a Core Shaker not work out well, honestly. And
but
it's very consistent.
It's very different when you're playing it as an offlaner, though. It's not a solo mid one. He played offlane, and he got a fast blink. He didn't get crushed in lane by the PA Witch Doctor lane. Arguably, Witch Doctor was moving quite a lot, but they did force him back to base once. And now he's level 11 with a blink dagger. 14 minutes in. This is what you would... his inventory is similar to what you would see from a solo midshaker at this point. Mm. Like, that's how much he's got. And that's with 38 CS. It's just all those kills and assists. And now, would you look at this? 3,000 gold, 5,000 experience lead for EP. I didn't like their chances in the start with how the laning stage went, but they have really managed to pull it back within the last 3 minutes.
But and of course, keep in mind, PR lost their first game. So this is, if they go down 0-2, that's pretty, I wouldn't say it's crippling yet, but it's going to become worrisome for sure. I mean, that is a huge deal. They definitely
Radiant's
don't want to be in
that.
Especially going
attack.
Against the team that I think people know the least amount about. I mean, this is kind of a wild card in EP. I mean, we make fun of their name a lot because it's awesome, but I mean, there's not a whole lot of history with this team. I mean, I think a lot of them are like pub stars, if I'm not mistaken, in the Chinese scene. But either way, as a result, they're considered, even though they are a wild card, both literally and figuratively, they're still considered the weakest.
They're literally team. A card.
Literally. A wild one. Joker.
I think the most important thing about this to think about is that when we talked about it on the panel earlier today, we were considering who were the favorites to come out of this wild card round and make it through. The top two make it, the other ones don't. And if PR lose this game, PR was one of our favorites to make at least to make those two slots. And if not, then get third, right? If they lose this game too, they're down 0-2. And then you don't make top two without winning the remaining three games. That means if they lose this game, they put themselves in a position where they have to beat the favorites HGT, which, in addition to winning the other two games, and it's best of ones, you don't know what happens. I mean, this could just be a bad game for PR, but you don't get any second chances. So yeah,
there's very little wiggle room as far as that's concerned. Tidehunter has Ravage available. We go for the Gush Anchor Smash combination. Io's just going to TP out unless Ravage is used, and he does
global
just that.
Global silence.
Oh, they actually get Tiny with the Berserker's Call at the last second. Chainfrost on top of that's not really going to bounce too much. Maledict applied as well. This is a dead Tiny. Call of Blade wasn't enough. Either way, they get the kill. It's a 1-for-1.
Oh, PA got that kill. That's huge.
Let's look at PA. So Helm of the Dominator. I mean, this is like the inventory from last game. But that was like 25 minutes in.
This time BKB is a lot better as well.
Oh, yeah.
If she gets a BKB next, she's going to be fit for fighting. In addition to all the crazy teamfight abilities, I mean, when you look at PR's lineup, on paper, it should be extremely good at getting into fights with EP. If they're in the right position, if they land any half-decent Ravage together with Chainfrost or Berserker's Call, they should be able to bring down targets. But the global silence is, of course, a problem. And the fact that they don't really get those teamfights. EP are playing Skirmish, which is the best way of playing against this PR lineup, because their teamfight is so good, but their skirmishing is not that good when you look at it, right? It's kind of like they want this wombo combo, and if you don't get it, well, what do you really have? There's a call. Fissure is available.
Into the Sunstrike, into Enchant Totem, into the right click, Glaives of Wisdom on top of all this. He's going to use Echo Slam to secure the kill. Not even 100% sure if that was necessary, but wanted to be safe.
This silencer has stolen 22 intelligence.
Holy crap, you're right. That is insane. It's not even a core silencer. Initiation again. Ravage is going to be applied to four heroes. They're going to clean up the Wisp with no problem. Earthshaker, Cask, that means the death of him as well. Tiny, in the meantime, along with Silencer, in a lot of trouble. Going to get the toss off onto Lich. He's going to stand his ground because he is super slow at the moment. Attempting to run away with that Yasha that has the Hyperstone as well. Sunstrike's not going to connect. Right clicks to follow. Toss, still not enough to finish off J4. He really wants his kill. Might even get it with the cleave. Nope. They should be able to finish him off, although Silencer does. It's a 1-for-1 trade in that respect. Silencer now going to attempt to TP out. The crit is there. They're going to finish him off as well. 4-for-2. Make it a... He died in Fountain? Oh, he died right here.
Yeah.
I thought he TP'd that. Okay.
He died to Last Word on the Phantom Assassin. Yeah, that was another crazy fight. I want to quickly revisit the fact that Silencer has stolen all this intelligence. He's stolen 24, and that doesn't just mean that he becomes very powerful and can transition into a core role. By the way, he has more than half an Ags already on that Silencer, so it's not out of the question. But that int is also stolen from the Radiant heroes. And with all those deaths they have on their heroes here, it's... If, let's say, Axe dies once or twice more with Silencer in the neighborhood, that's actually a pretty big deal. His mana pool is already reaching a level where he's going to be struggling to cast all his abilities. He gets some great spins here. That's going to be a kill on Luffy. But all of the stolen
like
on Silencer.
See. I would like to...
Gonna get scary.
I wish there was an indicator of how much int has been stolen from each specific hero. That would be cool to see.
That would be very nice to have.
But yeah, Axe's mana pool is generally not good anyway, but this... pretty damn low overall.
And it's the same if you look at a hero like PA. She has a low mana pool and also low mana costs, but if you get cursed in a fight and you are globaled at the same time, you can lose your entire mana pool with this low amount of mana. That's a pretty big deal when you're playing without a stick, so you have no way of getting it back up, and P PA's team fight potential is horrible when she can't blink. Like, she just gets kited all day by this IO Tiny. So, scary stuff for PR going forward in this game. I think that last team fight for them was definitely good enough, courtesy of a great Ravage from Shashlo. They're going to need more of that. Ooh, this is a pretty bold Roshan attempt.
Alright, tell me something happens. I'm changing my mind.
Ravage is ready in 10 seconds. I think they are aware that this might be happening at least, but no one's there just yet, Lei. Gonna keep supporting Fan here, giving him some health with the tether.
Ravage is available. They're gonna see the smoke dissipate right off the bat. Fissure to follow. He's gonna go for the Wisp right off.
Perfect
Silencer
global.
Used. His ult. And with that, they're gonna clean up Axe with absolutely no problem whatsoever. They can probably just go for Roche now. Of course, Ravage is still available, so something to fear. But without that Axe, Radiant's I feel like that's most of your damage right now. Under attack. Unless you get grouped up with J4 ult on top of Ravage, that's definitely something to fear as well.
There's Necro one ult being
used on top of this. Shashlo gets fissured again, and Cold Snapped, and everything in between. Poor guy.
Cold Snapped together with Curse of the Silence is actually really annoying. There goes Roche. And Fan almost has a Keras as well, together with a Yasha. This Tiny is incredibly fat. It's going to be very difficult for PR to deal with this. The PA BKB is about 200 off, which is one step in the right direction, but I really want to commit the Silencer so far. I think his globals have been pretty much perfect. The one right there prevents the Ravage. They get a free kill on the Axe. And I was questioning the pick in the start. I was like, well, hopefully they don't pick this only for the global. And that's definitely not been the case. Last word and the curses have been really important. He's managed to steal a lot of int as well by being in the proximity of the kills. So as a result of that, he's now 1,000 off the Axe Scepter. And the curse is going to be a big problem. They already have low mana, as we talked about. Like, we're about at the point where we need a really big comeback for PR to come back in this. It's not even a close game anymore.
When you give this much space to a Tiny Wisp, it's just, it snowballs, obviously. Like you said, Kyrus, I think it's done, yeah. He actually needs the chainmail. He's doing that right now. So that is a full Assault Kyrus to go along with the Aghanim Scepter on the Tiny. And Yasha. Expect the Manta to follow after that fact. Phantom Assassin has the BKB. Does she go for Manta herself as well? Because if you BKB before the silence, which is kind of needed, and then when you get silence, not that necessarily that important to silence PA, but Manta, I mean, is good in general, and it takes off the global silence as well.
I think if the game situation was different, she could go for that, but she's the only carry, right? She has to hit hard. I think Manta doesn't give enough bang for your buck at this point. You need an Abyssal Blade so you can really get some big crits off. Lock down the Tiny as well, who's probably going to get a BKB as his next item, we can assume, because then he's just like absolutely unstoppable in these fights. The Manta idea is good enough, but yeah, they're going to
the game was closer.
Yes, perhaps that could be a choice.
Oh, the avalanche too late.
I think he could have made that.
Cheshire Cat looking to initiate. But thinking better of it, considering Tiny is dominating right now with 11.
Man, this was an Axe that destroyed his lane. He is very poor at this point. Surprised he isn't going for a Blade Mail as well. I thought that would have been a decent choice. I understand he wants the BKB against this team, but at the end of the day, the Blade Mail is still useful if you get globaled. And if you get any sort of decent call into the Blade Mail, that could set you up to win that fight. Whereas this BKB that he's building on, as long as he does the build-up, it's pretty much useless. Like, this Ogre Club isn't making a difference. So he really needs to finish that BKB, maybe be a little more greedy for the farm so they get a return on that investment. Considering how much he was owning in the early game, he's got to be feeling a little bit disappointed with his impact on the game right now.
At the same time, Shashlo here on the Tidehunter is getting closer and closer to that Refresher. Just needs the recipe, so another 1,600 gold or so, which still is a ways away, I guess, but getting closer. Fan, counter world. God, it's so ridiculous how long the range of that tree is as far as auto attacks are concerned. Even now, a Blink Dagger luxury item picked up by Wisp very shortly here. That is interesting in its own right, just because, I mean, we've seen a lot of cool plays where you get relocated back in a dire situation, and you just blink out and you're fine, but I mean, it's a complete luxury item, obviously.
I think he's mainly getting it to dodge the Ravage, to be honest. So he can just, like, reset out and then come back in again. Mm-hmm. So he can blink out and then tether into Tiny. That could work.
Oh, the dunk! Okay.
On to PA.
Oh, my goodness. Sunstrike, everything. I mean, they barely expended anything, honestly. I said everything, but really nothing other than the Echo Slam. And that's fully worth it for the hard carry PA to get that kill. I mean, now what do they have? They have the Ravage. They have Axe Initiation. They have a decent amount of team fight potential, but they don't have any singular right clickers other than that PA. And that means a tier 2.
Wait, is this a bug?
Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
That's weird.
Wait a minute.
What is that?
Wait a He tethers in and then blinks out, and then the tether never reaches. So he actually has a 2K range tether. What the fuck?
Wow. That.
This is so broken. I don't think I've seen this.
Seen that. No way. Sunstrike. It's not going to be.
That's ridiculous. Look at it.
That is pretty broken overall. Tiny Force has the Aegis of the Immortal. Doesn't care about going down.
What?
That Maledictus Syndrome is going to continue to be flabbergasted by this ridiculous range of the tether. Dunk is there. Should be able to finish off this Rax with pretty much. Here comes the Ravage. It's only going to hit a couple, though. And Wisp is always available with that ridiculously long tether. Tiny,
never mind,
right click
dead.
Axe. Global Silence used on top of this. Chain Frost. Is it going to bounce? It does once. Stifling Dagger on top of Earthshaker, who can go back right in. PA. Phantom Strike. Still not enough. They're going to apply all the pressure.
I think PR are making a mistake chasing this. They're all going to die if they go for this now.
They're all going to die! Well, Curse of the Silent now. There's the
good blink strike.
Gonna
still going to lose one.
Man, man. There's the toss on top of Earthshaker. And now PA on the run. He's going to blink strike into his base. Three dead for PR. EP might back up here. Don't necessarily need to. They have all the outer towers.
This Tiny is really low health. A lucky crit could bring him down. At the same time, a lucky Craggy could end the game.
Yeah, Wisp could relocate himself back into the fight.
Yeah, he won't
do just that.
Let's see if he has another blink trick up his sleeve. Dodging the relocate back resist.
That's unbelievable.
That's still kind of crazy. Because to be honest, this is an interaction that, if this has been in the game for a very long time, it's weird it hasn't really been discovered until. Because that's a play you would imagine you would make once in a while. So if you tether onto a target and before you reach the max tether range, you blink out, do you think, like, could he in theory just have run as far away as he wanted? Or would the tether break after like 2,000 range? That's a good question.
No clue. Looks like they're going to pick off Invoker. But their mid racks is completely destroyed.
Not enough fighting.
Roshan, we're not going to know if he's going to be up for another couple minutes. And Tiny, what is he going to add to his repertoire now? He has 4,300 gold.
I'd buy a BKB
right
that
now. Manta? Could be BKB. Looks like we have a heart. It's going to be a heart.
For who?
Tiny.
He hasn't bought anything. Buy the recipe?
Yeah, the recipe's on the courier.
Oh, okay. Yeah, then he has a full heart.
It's like, all right, you don't have any earn charges, Wisp. I'll just heal myself with a freaking heart. BKB picked up by Axe now.
It's
is
too
it
late.
Too little too late?
It's too late. There is a chance for PR to come back in this game, but they're about 20,000 gold behind. So what it takes now is for PA to get a couple of really good crits on the right targets. The problem is with Tiny with this heart, I actually don't see him dying unless if they put everything onto him, but if he has an Aegis, there is no way he dies twice. And they can't catch this Wisp because of that blink trick. Like, usually what you do with Wisp is that you tether onto the Tiny and then you try to stay at, like, a decent range so the tether doesn't break and so you're not exposed at the same time. But he, like, doubles that range with that play. And I would imagine that the reason he doesn't run further away with the tether, it's possible that the tether is infinite in length, but if he runs too far away, he can't recast it instantly. But if he just stays at about 2K range...
Do you think this is kind of like abusing a bug to the point where...
This is...
Like the admins will have to look at it?
No.
That's pretty insane.
It's not. That's not how generally tournaments work. Like, the way of looking at it is that, for example, at TI, the rule is if it's in the game, it goes.
Talking about the Pudge Hook?
For example, the Pudge Hook, you saw the Elder Titan thing that Aoi used. That wasn't a TI, though, but if it works mechanically, then if this is broken, it'll get fixed. I honestly don't think it's a game winner here. I think they would have won the game anyway, the way it looks right now. Obviously, the game isn't over, but it's very, very close, right? But the general consensus is if it's available, it's okay to use. Now, the problem is, let's say there's a game-breaking bug that's something in the game where you click a button and you get 20,000 gold on your hero. Then that's a problem. So I guess it's case-by-case basis. If it's completely game-breaking and ridiculous, then maybe you replay the game. But this isn't... I mean, okay, this time it broke.
He messed it up.
It broke this time. Interesting. Ruh-roh. Is that because he's got smoked, or was it because he blinked too early?
So many questions, so little answers. This is the initiation from Cheshire Cat. Echo Slam on top of the Global Science. That's two dead right off the bat for PR. That's a buyback for Witch Doctor. But Axe is now dead as well. As the right clicks continue, Ravage onto three. Decent Ravage overall. But he's going to get cleaned up with a couple right clicks and Enchant Totem. Sineko couldn't even get down his Death Ward in his first death. It looks like he's going to get down a second time. And EP completely dominating fashion. And he's PR in all likelihood to go down 0-2 in his wild card, the Dota 2 Asia Championship. And we didn't even mention Silencer Ags, I don't think. That's insane. Oh, man.
Yeah, this game is over. They're not even going to respawn in time. Tiny can clean this up before they come back. So, wow. I am really surprised with this.
Wow.
Obviously, this was one of the teams we didn't know that well coming in because most of their players, like you said, are not really established in the competitive scene. But if EP play like this every game, I actually think they have a shot at getting top two. It's not
good.
Out of the question. And it's best of ones if they can take a game against who we arguably have to say are probably the favorites right now, Na'Vi and HTT. A game against either could put them at the very least in a tiebreaker position for second place. This was really... I don't know. Not what I expected.
Dat Tether. Can't wait to see that.
Yeah, there's going to be some reactions to that. I mean, regardless of what your point of view is on it, I think it's fair to say that it was not game-winning here. I don't think it made a big difference,
yeah,
but...
I agree.
Still, it's an interesting interaction, and I think this is going to get fixed. I'm pretty sure.
But this game, in a nutshell, that one fight bottom lane, ultra kill for Tiny, that's when it just completely flipped and never went back in the favor of PR.
Exactly.
Let's go back to the camera.
Da-da-da.
So next we have Speed Gaming versus Wings at 2300 PST. I can't tell what time it is.
So that is in about 45 minutes. Another very quick game.
Yep.
So I guess we're going to have a short break.
We'll have a short break. I don't know about you. I'll probably do more camera stuff if you guys are interested in talking. I don't know. I find it more fun than having some overlay on. So we'll be back.
More break and stake.
Sure.
Come on.